Welcome to the Author Interviews for Liberty Matters, a bi-monthly forum where various authors and texts available on the Online Library of Liberty. The Online Library of Liberty is part of the Liberty Fund network of websites. For more information about Liberty Fund, visit our webpage at www.libertyfund.org. I'm Pat Lynch, Senior Fellow at the Liberty Fund, and today I'm joined by Ruth Skirr, who has written the lead essay for our August 2020 forum on J.S. Mill and life writing. If you'd like to watch any of the other interviews by the authors of our response essays for this forum, or any of the other interviews in this series, please visit our YouTube channel. A link to the forum itself on the Online Library of Liberty is also on our YouTube channel. Ruth Skirr is a fellow at Gonville and Caius College, Cambridge, where she is the Director of Studies in Human, Social, and Political Sciences. She was educated at St. Bernard's Convent, SLAW, Oxford University, and Cambridge University. She won a British Academy postdoctoral fellowship in 2000. She is the author of Fatal Purity, Robespierre and the French Revolution, which won the Franco-British Society Literary Prize in 2006 and was listed among the 100 best books of the decade by The Times in 2009. It has been translated into 5 languages. Her second book, John Aubrey, My Own Life, received rave reviews in major literary outlets in the UK and the US. It is an act of scholarly imagination that the Times Literary Supplement described as a formidable and astonishing achievement. Ruth, it is a great pleasure to have you with us today for this author interview for Liberty Matters. Welcome.
Thank you, Pat.
Well, thank you for participating and really opening the discussion up with a very lively and provocative essay. And I'm going to start with the title itself. Your book about John Aubrey, and it's it really is a tremendous book, and I recommend it to all of our viewers to take a look at it and hopefully read it. But it's an interesting book because what you did, and I hope you get a chance to describe the project, was that you essentially created a biography for Aubrey using original source material and then stitching it together. Can you maybe explain that project, but also talk a little bit how you brought that perspective on what you call life writing to this essay, and perhaps explain a little bit about life writing as well?
Yeah, so what I did was actually to create a diary for him. So it was very much in the first person autobiographical account of his life, which he didn't leave us, even though he was a pioneer biographer. So he spent his life collecting the details of his contemporaries like John Milton and other important politicians, etc. And he didn't actually, apart from a few scrappy pieces of paper, think his own life was worthy of a full-length treatment. So what I did was to pull together all the insights into his own life and assemble them in the diary form. So one of the reasons that I use the term life writing is because it's broader than the strictly biographical, and it enables us to include memoir, autobiography, and a broader range of approaches to how we tell the story of an individual's life.
So how does that help us think about the autobiography? How does that help us understand Mill's autobiography, but also the approach that he took and the things he was trying to accomplish?
Mm-hmm. So Mill famously is very self-consciously crafting a story. He's crafting the story of his life. And we can use some of the techniques that we would use for thinking about novels or in my own case, writing the imagined diary to have some insight into the choices that Mill himself is making about his own life. And at the very beginning, you know, he's very clear. Of course, he's leaving stuff out. This is not, he wants to be very, he levels with the reader to say that, you know, of course, you know, he can't tell everything, but these are the things that he really wants to explain as part of his personal story. So already there is a very interesting set of choices going on there on Mill's part. And I think that the sort of focus that I tried to bring on his own relationship to life writing, how the lives of others through reading, through example, had affected him, can help us to see some of the approaches that he's taking when it comes to actually leaving a record of his own life. And it's very funny, really, because, I mean, he says some quite contradictory things. I mean, he says he wants to leave this record because he's worried about the pretend biographies that might come afterwards. And you could think of that as quite self-aggrandizing. You know, he's pretty confident that there's going to be money to be made, it seems, from these jobbing biographers who might take his life and try to write some kind of blockbusting, best-selling book about it. And when we actually reflect on what Mill's life consisted in, this idea seems pretty far-fetched. I mean, it would not actually make a racy biographical bestseller by a jobbing biographer. It's very much a speculative, he's a reflective life, and that's why he's interested in the other lives of the philosophers, and that's why that's such an important aspect for him. So I think he's positioning his life as an example of a life devoted to philosophy and to thought, and yet at the same time is frightened that someone like him, will attract scandal and misrepresentation.
So this is an interesting question. I want to jump off on the philosophical life point first. Although I do want to turn to the possibility of some controversy in his life a little bit later on. But in the essay, you mention how much Turgot and the biography that Condorcet wrote about him influenced him. It's interesting because that's a life where Turgot was trying to fundamentally reform France, the economy and the political economy, but he failed ultimately. But what Mill draws on is the rejection of labels, or at least in your essay, that's the main message that you're trying to draw. Did Mill understand the sort of tension there that this life that he was so influenced by, this biography that he was so influenced by, was the life of an individual who was very much an idealist and that it was not practically and tangibly successful? Was this an attempt for Mill to say, I may be ahead of my time, that I, you know, perhaps even though the ideas are correct, they have not been proven correct in my lifetime? Or was it really simply that freeing of the label from that rejection of utilitarianism moved Mill?
Okay, so you've got two things going on there. What does Mill understand about Turgot and Turgot's life and the way in which Turgot was attempting liberal economic reforms and a pioneer indeed in arguing for those, and the first attempts seemed to have ended in failure. And I think Mill's understanding of that is extremely engaged and very, very accurate, so that's absolutely of interest to him in its own right, because he obviously is very interested in liberal ideas and how those can be applied to the economy. I mean, in a sense, he's the next generation trying to follow through on some of those insights that Turgot had. So he would look back to Turgot as someone of immense importance. But then I think the second thing that's going on is that he finds in the life of Turgot something that's of even more intimate help to him in noticing in Condorcet's life of Turgot this highlighting of the way in which Turgot rejected labels, that he wouldn't accept the categorization of philosopher or anything else. He reserved for himself the opportunity for independent thought, and he didn't want to be a fellow traveler of any of those possible movements. And for whether or not that's actually true in Turgot's case, I mean, the extent to, I mean, you could say perhaps Condorcet was exaggerating the extent to which Turgot was completely rejecting all of those labels. But what is clear is that when Mill reads that and sees that, he feels a resonance with it. It helps him to step back from the philosophical framework within which he had been raised and to start to raise questions about that. And obviously in the responses to my essay, very interestingly from Jeremy Jennings, there are questions to be raised about to what extent Mill ever actually did successfully throw off that philosophical inheritance that he had from his father and James Mill and Jeremy Bentham. But nevertheless, it's interesting to me that he seems to be able to take an account of another life, a life that he very much admires, one that in a sense is the kind of life he might aspire to as a young man, and feel liberated by the account that Condorcet gives of Turgot's refusal to be categorized, basically.
Well, we eventually we have to turn to the father, because it's something, something I want to raise with all the other interviews because everyone's got a very strong opinion about this. So, and you actually mentioned it in your essay with relation to another biography. And so I have to ask this, and I think it's something that's obviously with Mill, you have to discuss it, but how do you see the relationship between father and son, both in the education, the formation, but then I think you focus more on the sort of later years after his father passes, and that then trying to grapple with that legacy of utilitarianism. How do you view the relationship between father and son, and how this the autobiography is trying to shape that as a legacy?
I think that's an obviously incredibly complex question. And one of the things I wanted to highlight in the essay, or at least in my responses to some of the comments on my essay, is that's actually a really complex question in relation to anybody, like their actual orientation towards their father or their mother. It's a very, very deep, and in Mill's case, we have the added layer of the philosophical positioning of the two of them. So I think it's really important to acknowledge right from the beginning that those two things are going on in this account that he leaves. Yes, you know, it is an account of his, you know, famous youthful nervous breakdown, which is the time where he starts to reject the label of utilitarian, which he himself has actually participated in coming up with in his even younger years. So we see that, but we also see the more emotional Mill, and the extent to which those two are interacting within the text that he chooses to leave is really, really fascinating. And that's why I looked sort of forward to the later responses he had when his father's friend Bentham was so criticized. And Mill is incredibly defensive of that, you know, he says, well, you know, there's if you wrote down every angry, sharp thing that your friend said about their best friend, and then you compiled that, of course, you would end up with a very, very skewed picture of a person. Now, I personally think that we as biographers or as life writers, we want to have as many of those accounts as we possibly can. So with the one of the responses to my essay was to say, well, was I saying that Mill thought people shouldn't have been critical of Bentham's life? Of course not. I mean, I think even Mill probably thought that because he was being very protective, but we want all those records. We want to know what Bentham said about James Mill off the record, and it would be, we would be impoverished if we didn't have that. So I'm going back to John Aubrey, the pioneer biographer we began speaking about. This was absolutely the kind of information that he noted down. He wanted to record exactly what, you know, your best friend or your child had to say about you, so that it could be passed forward. And it's those sort of private, unofficial insights into what somebody might have been saying or feeling that become very valuable in life writing. So I think Mill is a very complex figure to place in this area. He's got many purposes, and I was trying to explore really how we can accept that they're all present in the text.
So it's interesting because you raise the question of getting as much information as possible. I think my background is actually in empirical work, so I'm a big fan of collecting as much data as possible. But you push it even a little bit further in your essay because, and this is on the bottom of page 9 as I printed it out, it'll be towards the end of the essay for those of us, those folks reading it online. You're discussing Carlyle's History of the French Revolution, and I do want to talk a little bit about the French Revolution if we have time and the impact that it had on Mill. But you say something very interesting. You say that reading Carlyle's French Revolution had broadened Mill's understanding of the genres within which biography could be written by breaking down the rigid distinction between fiction and nonfiction. So this suggests to me that biography does not merely have to be facts and data. It can actually be impression, or it can be speculation, if I'm understanding fiction correctly, or am I not getting that passage correct?
No, that's right. I mean, again, the story behind Carlyle's French Revolution and Mill's role in that is so absolutely fascinating. So Carlyle's book really is the result of him taking on Mill's original project from the review of Scott's life of Napoleon, where Mill actually is focusing on the early books of Scott's life, which are about the revolution. And he's very irritated by Scott's setting of the stage for Napoleon's life. And so he writes this review, almost all, I mean, he's a Napoleon person of no real interest whatsoever in comparison to these fascinating and exciting revolutionaries, right? And then Carlyle is the person who then takes on the quest of trying to do a better history of the French Revolution and to bring in something much more close to sort of narrative evocation of what those events actually were. And that's why I think that this kind of the distinctions between sort of narrative writing and the strictly empirical do start to break down. I mean, Carlyle is almost an orator, a rhetorician within the text, who's sort of breathing life into those debates in ways that probably Mill himself was never going to write like that and wouldn't have done it. But it's very interesting that the genesis of that book actually was in Mill's own review.
In his own research, as I recall.
Which he passed to Carlyle. Absolutely. Loads and loads of research. Fascinated. And yeah, he says, you know, if in the best thing as a very young man that he could have aspired to be would be to be his own kind of Girondin, to be his own kind of participant in those revolutionary events.
So one of the things, and I'll just touch on this briefly if we can, is this notion that Mill says that there have to be two scopes of history, the scientific and the biographic. And as you just said, the biographic is the area where Mill, and you discussed this in your essay, and this comes out in some of the review essays as well, that that because of Mill's formation, his education, particularly the impact of his father, he was not exposed to poetry and was not exposed to that ability to be able to breathe life necessarily into people. But the scientific aspect would have been a great strength of his had he chosen to write history. And it seemed as if most of the criticisms of the history that he wrote were that they failed to address that scientific piece adequately enough. So it's a really great observation. And is that a sort of a way to think about another dichotomy within history and biography, the sort of the putting into it, not only breathing life into those individuals, but putting them into the context of a broader flow of history?
Sure. I mean, I wouldn't want to overstate the absence of the poetic in Mill's, even in his upbringing, actually. I mean, it's quite clear that he does have the basic appreciation of poetry. You might feel that his father's education program didn't prioritize poetry enough, and that becomes one of the things that he is very keen to redress when he's rebelling against his upbringing. But it's definitely there from the very beginning. But I think it's clear from the kind of writing that Mill went on to do that much as he might admire biographical writing and feel it's extremely valuable, that his own commitment is to something which he understands, at least, as much more scientific.
Which would be philosophy in his part and the impact that had on him. I wanted to ask you, so we can sort of turn it back to Mill briefly. How did you first get engaged with Mill, and in terms of the viewers, so that our viewers can, who might not have a lot of experience reading Mill or might not have that opportunity, might not have the background to do it right away, where do you think a new reader should start introducing him or herself to Mill? Yeah, I mean, the obvious candidates would be on Liberty.
Absolutely with the autobiography. I mean, you know, whoever you are, you think about the books you read in childhood and the influence that your parents had on you. And Mill is giving, philosophical and learned account here of his background. But the basic narrative is of falling out with the values that his father had given him, and trying at the same time to reconcile feeling incredibly grateful to his father for, and he says in the text, you know, the amount of effort that this program of education, I mean, you know, I personally can't think of anything worse than trying to homeschool my children. I mean, I don't even get involved with their homework, you know, their homework is their business as well. I want my own essay crisis going on, thank you very much. To actually have your children at home on this idea that not only was Mill's father completely committed to the home education system that he had designed, but that then Mill himself was helping to educate his younger siblings in that structure, and I think everyone identifies with these questions about how best to educate your children, and how to think about the way in which you were educated has had an effect on the formation of your character. And that's really what Mill is writing about in the autobiography. I mean, that is his attempt to give an account of how the admittedly pretty extreme program of, you know, only learning Greek and then transitioning on to Latin, etc. But although it's right when people point out that possibly that wasn't so unusual as it sounds to us. I mean, to us, it just sounds absolutely far-fetched, but, you know, might not have been as completely anomalous then as it would be in our times. But I think that there's something, the fascination of those questions and how to think about whether or not the character you have is actually under your control, or whether or not there are forces in your upbringing that you simply, however free you want to be, can never overturn.
Well, this comes up in one of the essays that Georgios wrote with regards to shaping context, and I think it's a very, very important question. And I should also note to our viewers who will be viewing this in the future, we're taping this interview in September 2020, when homeschooling is a little less optional, particularly for those of us who have been accustomed to not having to do it. And so it's a rather timely topic. And certainly Mills, I think it's probably true that a classical education that would have been based on Greek and Latin would have been more common. That it was probably a little uncommon for him to be fluent in it by the time he was 8, I believe. Was translating that would have been rather extraordinary. So it's clearly an extraordinary mind.
And also I think extraordinary the relationship between him and his father. I mean, the way they go for afternoon walks and his father quizzes him on, you know, he has to sort of memorize large tracts and to be able to, and his father's harsh on him, you know. I mean, if he gets it wrong or you know, he remembers sternness from his father. And you think, you know, there's this little boy who's doing his best not only to get on top of Greek and Latin and do all this reading, but also to educate his younger siblings, and he's getting a hard time from his father every time there is a mistake.
Well, I think there was very little coddling of children in the 19th century, particularly in the Victorians, who were not big into coddling or sharing those sorts of things.
But so that again shows you, in a sense, that Mill is in his own way, he's a pioneer of noticing that actually that wasn't right. I mean, he says that very explicitly. He says, look, I don't remember the warmth. I don't remember the emotional exchanges with my father. And I think, you know, even if we think, well, Mill ended up pretty dry himself, you know, it's not like he wrote the kind of, you know, fantastically evocative and florid book on the French Revolution that Carlyle wrote, etc. The fact that he has that awareness of and the critical sort of assessment of the absence of emotional warmth in his upbringing, I think is very, very ahead of his time there.
The self-awareness that is clearly, there was some development there to be able to identify that as a fault. Mm-hmm. And something that would have been unusual for his time. I wanted to end with one final question, and this is something that has struck me during this essay exchange, and one that I think is important. I wanted your opinion on it. So Mill rejects the label utilitarian, but ultimately his thought is not exactly liberal. It is clearly classified as liberalism. Is he sort of a hybrid between the two trains of thought? Is he, in your view, firmly in the camp of liberalism? Does he lean more towards utilitarianism? Where would you put him, even though he rejected the label himself?
I do see Mill as liberal. I see him as someone who never ceases to struggle to reconcile the liberal values that he has with that broader utilitarian framework. As Jeremy was saying, you know, in some ways that could be seen as a failure. You know, why couldn't he just break free and become more straightforwardly an advocate of straight up liberal values? But I think it is very, very deep in him to keep trying to reconcile those values with the greater good and the wider society. And I think that's a very, very interesting place to be, actually. So I would claim Mill as a liberal, absolutely, but he's a complex liberal. You know, he is aware that it's not actually always that straightforward to be championing those values, that there are other implications and constraints that sometimes come into play, and he's trying to find a way to resolve those tensions.
Ruth Skirr, thank you very much for writing an outstanding essay for our Liberty Matters Forum, our lead essay this month. Thank you for a very stimulating interview, and thank you very much for your time participating in this interview process.
Thank you, Pat, and thank you to the Liberty Fund as well. Thank you.
It's our pleasure for hosting. Thank you again.